Welcome to the documentary on Central Civil Services Conduct Rules 1964, presented by Principal Controller of Defense Accounts, Southwestern Command Army, Jaipur. Conception and patronage by Shri Saroj Kumar, IDAS, Principal Controller of Defense Accounts, Southwestern Command Army.
I have gone through the documentary on CCS Conduct Rules 1964, created by Principal Controller of Defense Accounts, Southwestern Command, Jaipur. Since knowledge of conduct rules is a must for all central government employees, for easy understanding, the rules have been explained in very informative and lucid manner. The doubts have been clarified through a question and answer session. It is my firm belief that this documentary will provide an in-depth knowledge and understanding of various conduct rules governing the central government employees. I compliment all the officers and staff of Principal CDA Southwestern Command Jaipur for creating such a useful documentary.
Defense Accounts Department comes under the Ministry of Defense with the Controller General of Defense Accounts as its head. It is one of the oldest central government departments functioning for more than 270 years. The duties of Defense Accounts Department are broadly audit, payment, accounting and financial advice to the armed forces, ordnance factories, border roads, DRDO, Coast Guard, etc. The department is also responsible for making payment of pension to retired armed forces personnel including defense civilians. The mission statement of our department is, we strive to achieve excellence and professionalism in accounting and financial services and in performing audit functions. The quality policy of our department is, the Defense Accounts Department is committed to render efficient, correct and prompt accounting, payment and financial services leading to customer satisfaction. It is also committed to render efficient audit services to ensure public accountability.
मित्रों, हमारे ग्रंथों में लिखा गया है कि वृत्तेन ही बहुत त्यार्या ना धनेन न विद्या, अर्थात मनुष्य चरित्र से ही श्रेष्ठ होता है, धन या विद्या से नहीं। अंग्रेजी में भी एक कहावत है कि इफ वेल्थ इज लास्ट नथिंग इज लास्ट, इफ हेल्थ इज लास्ट समथिंग इज लास्ट, इफ कैरेक्टर इज लास्ट एवरीथिंग इज लास्ट। इन्हीं कथनों को दृष्टिगत रखते हुए हमारी सरकारें समय समय पर अपने कर्मचारियों से दैनिक कार्यों के निर्वहन में सत्यनिष्ठा, ईमानदारी, कर्तव्यपरायणता एवं पारदर्शिता की अपेक्षा रखती हैं। इन्हीं मूल्यों के विकास के लिए CCS कंडक्ट रूल्स 1964 का निर्माण किया गया है। इन नियमों के अंतर्गत सरकार अपने कर्मचारियों से एक विशेष प्रकार के आचरण की अपेक्षा करती है और उन्हें कदाचार से बचने की सलाह देती है। इन नियमों का ज्ञान होना सभी कर्मचारियों के लिए आवश्यक ही नहीं वरन अपरिहार्य भी है, क्योंकि अज्ञानता के कारण हम कभी भी नियमों की अवमानना की पेचीदगियों में फंस सकते हैं। इससे बचने के लिए तथा सभी कर्मचारियों के ज्ञानवर्धन के लिए हमने एक डॉक्यूमेंट्री ऑन CCS कंडक्ट रूल्स 1964 पर बनाने का प्रयास किया है। यह पूरी तरह से हमारे कार्यालय के कर्मचारियों और अधिकारियों द्वारा निर्मित है। आशा है कि यह डॉक्यूमेंट्री आप सभी को पसंद आएगी तथा ज्ञान बोधक होने पर हम सभी सरकार के प्रयासों में अपना अमूल्य योगदान प्रदान कर सकेंगे। धन्यवाद।
This documentary on CCS Conduct Rules 1964, prepared by Principal Controller of Defense Accounts, Southwestern Command Army, Jaipur, is for use in trainings and general awareness of the central government servants. The objective of this documentary is to spread knowledge of CCS Conduct Rules among central government servants in a more practical way. The statements of the faculty and expert panel are for illustrative purpose and may not be quoted as authority. The authority which is to be quoted is only CCS Conduct Rules 1964 and relevant government orders.
Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic, that is Central Civil Services Conduct Rules 1964, abbreviated as CCS Conduct Rules 1964, through an audio video documentary film. This documentary will be helpful and guiding to all the central government employees, especially our newly recruited colleagues. As we all are aware that every government employee holds certain responsibilities which comes with his post, they have to adhere with certain kind of standard of conduct at both in official capacity as well as in private capacity. They must follow a particular behavior so that it could not embarrass the government at any point of time. To enforce this, there are certain rules and regulations which describes the acts and responsibilities of the central civil servants, and one of the major guidelines is CCS Conduct Rules 1964. At the outset, I would like to highlight the importance of conduct rules. Why a government employee need to know them? Sometimes a government employee feels, unless I know the conduct rules, I may violate the same and may be excused by disciplinary authorities. But it is not so. Violation of any conduct rule due to its unawareness shall not exonerate a government employee from initiating any action against him under Central Civil Services Classification Control and Appeal Rules 1965. So, it is the primary responsibility of all the government employees to get themselves aware and properly acquainted with the conduct rules as early as possible for their own benefit. The conduct rule have been derived from Article 309 of the Indian Constitution by the government, where it has been provided that recruitment and conditions of service of persons appointed to public services and posts in connection with the affairs of the union or any state may be regulated through the appropriate legislature. In this context, I would also like to make it clear that CCS Conduct Rules 1964 explains about the code of conduct, means various do's and don'ts to be followed by the government employee. However, CCS CCA Rules 1965 specifies the procedures to be followed for initiating the disciplinary action in case of omission or commission of any conduct rule. Total 25 rules have been formed to highlight the conduct of any government employee during office hours as well as during his day-to-day life. Non-adherence to these rules by the government officials may lead to unbecoming of government servant, and which may further attract administrative or disciplinary actions and major minor penalties under CCS CCA Rules 1965. In this documentary, first we shall try to understand the rules one by one through a PowerPoint presentation followed by a doubts clarification session by our expert panel on the subject. Now over to our distinguished faculty, Shri Vijay Kumar Mishra, for explanation of rule 123 of CCS conduct rules 1964.
Hello everyone. We start with the first rule, which is about short title, commencement and applicability of CCS conduct rules. These rules are called Central Civil Services Conduct Rules 1964. These rules were notified by Government of India Ministry of Home Affairs notification dated 30th November 1964 and published in the Gazette of India on 12th December 1964. Now, these rules are applicable to every person appointed to a civil service or post, including a civilian in defense services, in connection with the affairs of the union, except members of All India Service who comes under All India Service Conduct Rules 1968, railway employees who comes under Railway Services Conduct Rules, and any post for which these rules not to be implemented as per directions of the President of the Union. Further, the terms used in these rules are defined under Rule 2 of CCS Conduct Rules 1964. In these rules, unless the context otherwise requires, the government means the central government, government servant means any person appointed by government to any civil service or post in connection with the affairs of the union, including a civilian in defense service. Now, Rule 2 states that member of family in relation to a government servant includes the wife or the husband of the government servant, son or daughter wholly dependent on government servant, any other related person wholly dependent on the government servant. Now, we come to Rule 3. Rule 3 is one of the most important rule of CCS conduct rules 1964, which explains general guidelines for all government servants to be strictly adhered to. Total 21 sub rules have been formed under Rule 3.1. As per Rule 3.1, every government servant shall at all times maintain absolute integrity, maintain devotion to his duties, do nothing which is unbecoming of a government servant. This implies that we should abide by all the constitution provisions, government rules and regulations.
Excuse me, sir, what is an unbecoming of government servant?
The word unbecoming is a broader word which means unsuitable, incorrect and improper actions. It implies that the acts of a government servant are not in conformity with the various rules, provisions, guidelines of the CCS conduct rules 1964. This also covers disobeying of any statutory provisions and any act or guidelines specifically promulgated by Government of India. Non-adherence to these will make a government servant unbecoming of government servant. Consequently, suitable disciplinary action may be taken against the charged official. Further, sub rule 4 of rule 3.1 states that commit himself to and uphold the supremacy of the Constitution of India and our democratic values. Under Rule 5, defend and uphold the sovereignty and integrity of India, the security of the state, public order, decency and morality. Sub Rule 6 of Rule 3.1 states that every government servant is expected to maintain high ethical standards and honesty at every point of time. Sub Rule 7, political neutrality to be maintained. According to this, every government servant should do his duties entrusted by election commission during elections of union with utmost impartiality to ensure our democratic values.
Excuse me, sir, what are high ethical standards?
Every government employee has to maintain high ethical standards as per our conduct rules. Every government servant shall at all times maintain honesty, political neutrality, promote the principles of merit, fairness and impartiality in the discharge of their duties, maintain accountability and transparency. It also includes to maintain responsiveness to the public, particularly to the weaker section, maintain courtesy and good behavior with the public. These all comes under the ethical standards. Now, sub rule 8, which is Every government employee in his own capacity should promote principles of merit, fairness and impartiality in discharge of his duties. Under Subrule 9, transparency to be maintained and sense of accountability for each task done by him is to be maintained by each and every government servant. Subrule 10, responsiveness to the public, particularly to the weaker section, is most important. As we all aware that in our country, democratic values have highest importance, that is, government of the people, for the people and by the people. Rule 11, we have to maintain courtesy and good behavior with the public whom we are dealing with. Under Subrule 12, every government servant is expected to take decisions solely in public interest and use or cause to use public resources efficiently, effectively and economically. Subrule 13 states that to declare any private interest relating to public duties and take steps to resolve any conflict in a way that protects the public interest. Subrule 14, no one should place himself under any financial or other obligations to any individual or organization which may influence him in performance of his official duties. As per Subrule 15 of Rule 3.1, no one should misuse his position as civil servant and should not take decisions in order to derive financial or material benefits for himself, his family or his friends. Under Subrule 16, according to Subrule 16, every government servant is expected to make choices, take decisions and make recommendations on merit alone. Subrule 17 states that every government employee should act with fairness and impartiality and not discriminate against anyone, particularly the poor and the underprivileged section of the society. Subrule 18, as per Subrule 18 of Rule 3.1, every government employee should refrain from doing anything which is or may be contrary to any law, rules, regulations and established practices. Further, Subrule 19 of Rule 3.1 explains that a government employee should maintain discipline in discharge of his duties and be liable to implement the lawful orders duly communicated to him. Subrule 20 directs to maintain confidentiality in the performance of his official duties as required by any law, particularly with regard to information disclosure of which may prejudicially affect the sovereignty and integrity of India, the security of state, strategic, scientific or economic interest of the state, friendly relation with foreign countries or lead to incitement of an offence or illegal or unlawful gain or to any person. Further, Subrule 21 of Rule 3.1 states that everyone to perform and discharge his duties with the highest degree of professionalism and dedication to best of his abilities. Now, we come to Subrule 1 of Rule 3.2. According to this rule, every government servant holding a supervisory post shall take all possible steps to ensure the integrity and devotion to duty of all government servants for the time being under his control and authority. Means to motivate all the team members for prompt and proper discharge of official duties as per citizen charter and mission statement of the organization. Now, Subrule 2 of Rule 3.2 states that no government servant shall, in the performance of his official duties or in the exercise of powers conferred to him, act otherwise than in his best judgment, except when he is acting under the direction of his official superiors. Further, Subrule 3 of Rule 3.2 directs the superiors to issue direction to the juniors in writing ordinarily. Oral direction to subordinates shall be avoided as far as possible. Where the issue of oral direction becomes unavoidable, the official superior shall confirm it in writing immediately thereafter. Now, two explanations have been inserted by Department of Personnel and Training in 1986 under Rule 3, which is a government servant who habitually fails to perform the task assigned to him within the time set for the purpose and with the quality of performance expected to him shall be deemed to be lacking in devotion to duty, and on this basis suitable administrative action or disciplinary action may be initiated on the basis of these facts. Further, explanation 2 states that a government servant shall not evade from his responsibilities by seeking instructions from or approval of a superior officer or authority when such instructions are not necessary under the scheme of distribution of powers and responsibilities. Delegation of powers, which have been broadly explained under delegation of powers notified by Government of India, should be adhered to by every government official. Further, Rule 3A is about promptness and courtesy, which was inserted during July 95. As per this rule, no government servant shall act in a discourteous manner, nor adopt dilatory tactics in performing of his official duties. Further, Rule 3B directs us to strictly observe the government policies. This rule directs us to act in accordance with the government policies regarding age of marriage, preservation of environment, protection of wildlife and cultural heritage, and prevention of crime against women. Further, Rule 3C, inserted in conduct rules by Government of India, Department of Personnel and Training during November 2014, which is about prohibition of sexual harassment of working women. As per this rule, no government servant shall indulge in any act of sexual harassment of any woman at any workplace. Some acts have been specifically defined under this rule, which may come under the purview of sexual harassment. These are physical contact and advances, any demand or request for sexual favors, making sexually colored remarks, or showing pornography, or any other unwelcome physical, verbal, non-verbal conduct of a sexual nature.
I thank our faculty who has explained the introductory rules along with a very important rule of CCS conduct rules 1964, that is rule 3. After this explanation, we come to know that rule 3 is the soul of conduct rules. Through rule 3, a government servant has been advised to adhere some do's and don'ts in his public as well as private life. The most important ones are to maintain honesty, courteous behavior during public dealing, promptness in his official duties, high ethical standards, maintain absolute integrity, confidentiality in performance of his official duties. Do nothing which is against sovereignty and integrity of our country, security of the state, not to misuse his position and not to discriminate amongst caste, creed and sex. It is worth to mention here that originally there were only three sub-rules under Rule 3. Sub-rule 4 to 21 were added by Department of Personnel and Training letter issued during November 2014 to cover all the do's and don'ts for better understanding and broader perspective. Now, I would like to request to our next speaker, Mrs. Akanksha Shukla, who will make us aware of the intricacies of Rules 4 to 12 of CCS Conduct Rules 1964.
Hi everyone. Now, we are going to discuss from Rule 4 of CCS Conduct Rule 1964. Rule 4. It is about employment of near relatives of government servant in companies and firms. As per this rule, no government servant shall use his position or influence either directly or indirectly to secure employment for any member of his family in any company or firm. Now, one more important thing under this rule is that a government servant in officially discharge of his duties shall not sanction a contract to a company or firm if any member of his family is anyhow connected to that company or firm. Now, coming on the next rule, rule 5. This is about taking part in politics and elections. This says that no government servant shall be a member of any political party or any organization which takes part in politics, nor he himself shall take part in any political movement or activity. But yes, if a government servant exercises his right to vote, then he shall not give any kind of indication about endorsing any political party or agenda.
Excuse me, ma'am, I have a doubt. As per rule, a government employee has been prohibited to attend any political activity. So my question is, if a government servant attends any rally of a particular party, so will it come under violation of conduct rule?
Okay. Well, occasional attendance at any political meeting may not be construed as participation in a political movement or support of any political party. However, regularly attending meetings of the political parties will create an impression that he is the supporter of that political party or organization, which is against the conduct rules. Coming ahead, next is rule 6, which is about joining of association by government servant. It says that no government servant shall join or continue to be a member of an association whose objects and activities are prejudicial to the interest of sovereignty and integrity of India, public order or morality. In simpler words, we can say that a government servant cannot associate himself with an association whose interest conflicts with the interest of the union. Now, rule 7, which is about demonstration and strike. First of all, I would like to brief the word strike here. The word strike means mass abstention from work without prior permission, refusal to work overtime when it is required, or any other such practices. So, as per Rule 7, no government servant shall engage himself or participate in any demonstration which is prejudicial to the interest of sovereignty or integrity of India, security of the state, friendly relation with foreign states, public order, decency or morality, or which involves contempt of court, defamation or incitement to an offence. Let's move ahead. This is Rule 8. This is about connection with press or other media. As per this rule, no government servant shall, except with the previous sanction of the government, own wholly or in part, or conduct or participate in the editing or management of any newspaper or other periodical publication or electronic media. But this shall not be the case if a government servant in bona fide discharge of his official duties publishes a book or participate in a public media. Similarly, if the government servant publishes a book or participate in public media, then he shall make it clear that the views expressed by him are of his own and not that of the government. Now, let's move ahead and coming on the rule number 9, which is about criticism of government. According to this rule, this is about not to criticize the government or its policies in any manner. Nowadays, we see that expressing views on social media has become a practice. But as being a government servant, if one expresses his personal views or opinion about recent government policies which have adversely critical effect, then it will also come under breach of code of conduct. Now, Rule 10. This is about evidence before committee or any other authority. As per Rule 10, no government servant shall, except with the previous sanction of the government give evidence in connection with any inquiry conducted by any person, committee or authority. But this shall not apply when evidence is given in any judicial inquiry to an authority appointed by government, parliament or state legislature or to any departmental inquiry. Coming on the next rule, which is rule 11, this is about communication of official information. As per rule 11, every government servant shall, in performance of his duties in good faith, communicate information to a person in accordance with the Right to Information Act 2005 and rules made thereunder. See, the thing is that the government servant shall not communicate any classified document or information either directly or indirectly to any government servant or any other person to whom he is not authorized to do so. Now, coming on the rule 12, which is titled as subscription. As per rule 12, no government servant shall associate himself with the raising of any funds or other collection in cash or in kind in pursuance of any object whatsoever, but the members of the union can freely collect subscription among themselves for the welfare activities of the union.
Excuse me, ma'am, please clarify if any exception is there under this rule, as we all contribute to our association funds towards welfare activities.
Actually, funds may be collected for the welfare activities of any recognized association. Further, Flag Day collection for benefits of ex-servicemen, National Foundation for Communal Harmony for promoting communal harmony, and National Defense Fund contribution for the defense of the country are exempted under this rule.
With the explanation of rules 4 to 12, we have come to know that a government servant should maintain high ethical standards, not only during his official working but also during his public life, so that he may deliver his official responsibilities in an impartial and efficient manner and may represent government in a dignified manner. One more important thing in present context, that social media should not be used to criticize the government policies. Posting personal views on social media regarding government policies should be strictly avoided. Violation of this may attract disciplinary proceedings. Now, over to our next faculty, Ms. Anushree Bhatnagar, for explanation of rules 13 to 17 of CCS Conduct Rules 1964.
Hello everyone. Let's go ahead with rule number 13, which is gifts. And it states that a government servant shall not accept or permit any member of his family or any other person acting on his behalf to accept any gift which includes free transport, boarding, lodging or other service or any other pecuniary advantage. But a casual meal, lift or other social hospitality shall not be deemed to be a gift. Like on occasions such as weddings, anniversaries, funerals or religious functions, where acceptance of gift is a social practice, a government servant may accept gift, but he shall make a report to the government if the value of such gift exceeds ₹25,000 in the case of government servant holding Group A post, ₹15,000 for Group B post, and ₹7,500 for Group C post. Now comes rule number 13A, which is dowry, and it says that a government servant shall not give or take or demand directly or indirectly from the parent or guardian of a bride or bridegroom any dowry. The word dowry has the same meaning as in Dowry Prohibition Act 1961. Violation of the rule may attract disciplinary action against the delinquent. Now comes rule number 14, which is public demonstration in honor of government servant, and it states that A government servant shall take previous sanction of the government to receive any complimentary or valedictory address, to accept any testimonial, to attend any meeting or entertainment held in his honor, except a farewell on his retirement or transfer. Moreover, he shall not accept awards by private organizations having a monetary component. Now, let's move ahead to rule number 15, which is private trade or employment. And it states that a government servant needs previous sanction of the government to engage directly or indirectly in any trade or business, to negotiate for or undertake any other employment, or to hold an elective office, or to canvass for a candidate for an elective office, or to canvass in support of any business of insurance agency, commission agency, or owned or managed by any member of his family, or to take part in the registration, promotion, or management of any bank or other company registered or required to be registered. Now, there are few provisions where a government servant need not require prior sanction of the government, which are to undertake honorary work of a social or charitable nature, or to undertake occasional work of a literary, artistic, or scientific character, or to participate in sports activities as an amateur, or to take part in the registration, promotion, or management of a literary, scientific, or charitable society, or a club or similar organization, the aims or objects of which relate to promotion of sports, cultural, or recreational activities. Or he can also take part in registration, promotion, or management of a cooperative society substantially for the benefit of government servant. This rule also states that a government servant shall report to the government if any member of his family is engaged in a trade or business, or owns or manages an insurance agency or commission agency. There comes one more important point under this rule which is to be noticed, that is, a government servant may not accept any fee for any work done by him for any private or public body or any private person without the sanction of prescribed authority. Now comes rule number 15A, which is subletting and vacation of government accommodation. And it says that a government servant shall not sublet, lease, or allow any kind of occupation by any other person using government accommodation which has been allotted to him. In case of cancellation of allotment of government accommodation, a government servant shall vacate the same within the time prescribed by the allotting authority.
Excuse me, ma'am. In metro cities where government accommodation for newly recruited employees is mostly impossible to get, is there any provision of subletting in such cases?
No. As per conduct rules, it is not permitted in any case. Now, rule number 16, which is investments, lending, and borrowing. And it states that a government servant shall not speculate in any stock, share, or other investment, but he may make occasional investments. He shall also not indulge himself in lending and borrowing as a trade, but he may give or accept from a relative or a personal friend a purely temporary loan of a small amount free of interest. One more point to be discussed under this rule is that senior officers shall not approach their subordinates for standing surety for loans taken by them or by their relatives.
Excuse me, ma'am. What does the term small amount refers to?
Okay, actually it is not possible to define the term small amount comprehensively. Each case should be decided on merits, and in deciding such cases, the status of the individual concerned and the amount involved should be taken into account. Now comes rule number 17, which is insolvency and habitual indebtedness. And it states that a government servant shall so manage his private affairs as to avoid habitual indebtedness or insolvency. As per the rule, habitual indebtedness does not attract disciplinary proceedings against a government servant if it is due to some unforeseen circumstances. Thank you.
With the explanation of Rule 13 to 17, we understood that we are expected not to join any private employment even after office hours. Intention behind this is that the government employee should be fit to work for the government at any point of time. Neither we should involve ourselves in speculative investment to avoid any habitual indebtedness, nor accept costly gift or dowry. Now over to our next faculty, Ms. Priya Mittal, for explanation of rules 18 to 25 of CCS Conduct Rules 1964.
Hello all. Let's start with one of the very important rule of CCS Conduct Rules 1964, which is regarding movable, immovable and valuable property. According to this rule, every government servant shall, on his first appointment, submit a return of his assets and liabilities in a form as prescribed by the government. Assets includes both movable and immovable property acquired by the government servant, owned by the government servant or held by the government servant on lease or mortgage, either in his own name or in the name of any member of his family. Further, every government servant holding any Group A or Group B post submit an annual immovable property return in respect of every calendar year by 31st January of the next year. Now, according to sub-rule 2 of rule 18, a government servant, except with the previous knowledge of the prescribed authority, cannot acquire or dispose of any immovable property in any manner, where any manner means by lease, mortgage, purchase, sale, gift or otherwise, either in his own name or in the name of any member of his family. Further, when a government servant enters into a transaction in respect of movable property, either in his own name or in the name of any member of his family, he shall, within 1 month from the date of such transaction, report the same to the prescribed authority if the value of such transaction exceeds 2 month basic pay of the government servant. Now, one very important thing to tell you here is that if any transaction of immovable and movable property is with a person having official dealings with the government servant, then previous sanction of the prescribed authority shall be obtained by him.
Excuse me, ma'am, what are the items that comes under movable property?
Well, it is good to clarify it. Movable property basically includes jewelry, insurance policies, shares, securities and debentures. All loans, whether secured or not, advanced or taken by the government servant, and means of conveyance like car, scooter, etc., refrigerator, television sets, etc. But only those transactions need to be reported, the value of which exceeds 2 month basic pay of the government servant. Now comes Rule 18A, which is regarding acquisition and disposal of immovable property outside India and transaction with foreigners. And it states clearly that without the previous sanction of the prescribed authority, no government servant acquire or dispose of any immovable property situated outside India, nor he can enter into any transaction with any foreigner, foreign government, foreign organization or concern regarding acquisition and disposal of immovable property outside India. Moving on to our next rule, Rule 19, which is regarding vindication of acts and character of government servant. So, according to this rule, without previous sanction of the government, a government servant cannot take help of any court or press to vindicate any of his official act which is likely to attract adverse criticism from public. Please pay attention here that this rule does not prohibit a government servant from vindicating his private character or any act done by him in his private capacity.
Excuse me, ma'am, what does the term vindication mean?
Well, vindication means to prove yourself right or justified in doing something. In simpler form, to prove that what someone said or did was right or true, after other people thought it was wrong. Now comes Rule 20, which is regarding canvassing of non-official and other outside influence. According to this rule, no government servant shall bring or attempt to bring any political or other outside influence in respect of matters pertaining to his service under the government. Sometimes we see that government servant try to approach members of parliament or state legislature or other political or outside authorities to exert influence upon the superior authorities of our department relating to their service matters, like recruitment, appointment, promotion, posting to a particular station, expansion of adverse remarks, and out of turn allotment of government accommodation, etc. This is a clear cut violation of this rule. Now comes Rule 21, which is regarding restriction regarding marriage. According to this rule, no government servant shall marry with a person having a spouse living, and no government servant having a spouse living shall marry with a person except when it is permissible under the personal law applicable to the government servant and the other party to the marriage, and there are other grounds for so doing. Further, a government servant who has married or marries a person other than of Indian nationality shall intimate the fact to the government. Now comes to Rule 22, which is very important. It is regarding consumption of intoxicating drinks and drugs. According to this rule, a government servant shall strictly follow any law relating to intoxicating drinks or drugs in force in any area in which he is present physically. Secondly, during the course of his duty, he should not be under the influence of any intoxicating drink. Then he shall not appear in a public place in a state of intoxication. Further, he shall not use any intoxicating drugs or drinks to excess. Now comes to Rule 22A, which is regarding employment of children below 14 years of age. This rule has been added later in the year 1999 with a view to improve social and economic conditions of the children below 14 years of age. As per the rule, no government servant shall employ to work any child below the age of 14 years. The central government has also enacted Child Labour Prohibition and Regulation Act 1986 in keeping with the objective, which has been amended later in the year 2016 as Child and Adolescent Labour Prohibition and Regulation Act 1986. In case of any violation, necessary disciplinary action for violating the conduct rule as well as legal action may be taken against such a government servant. Moving on to our next rule, which is regarding interpretation. So if any question or any doubt arises relating to the interpretation of these rules so far discussed by us, it shall be referred to the government, whose decision thereon shall be final. Now comes to Rule 24, which is regarding delegation of power. And it states that the government may, by general or special order, direct that any power exercisable by it or any head of department under these rules, except the powers under Rule 23 and this rule, shall be exercisable also by such officer or authority as may be specified in the order. Now let's discuss the last rule of CCS Conduct Rule 1964, which is regarding repeal and saving. Any rule corresponding to these rules in force immediately before the commencement of these rules and applicable to the government servant to whom these rules apply are hereby repealed, provided that any order made or action taken under the rules so repealed shall be deemed to have been taken under the corresponding provisions of these rules. Secondly, provided that such repeal shall not affect the previous operation of the rules so repealed, and a contravention of any of the said rules shall be punishable as if it were a contravention of these rules.
After understanding rules 18 to 25, we come to know that being a government servant, it is our duty to inform our department for certain transactions of movable and immovable properties. We should also adhere to the various acts such as Child Labour Provision and Regulation Act 1986, amended in 2016, and Hindu Marriage Act 1955 with the explanation of Rule 18 to 25. We have concluded all the rules and their explanation and got clarity on the CCS conduct rules. Further, we have planned an FAQ session with our expert panel, which will be helpful in clearing any doubts in our mind on conduct rules. It is a great opportunity for all of us today to get benefited with the knowledge of our team of experts on the subject. And so feel free to clear your any doubts on the CCS conduct rules.
Sir, whether prior permission of department is necessary while filing a case in court of law for redressal of service grievances?
The answer to your question is no. No prior permission is as such required for filing any case in court of law for redressal of service grievances of the government servant. However, it is expected from a government servant to first exhaust the normal official channels of redressal before they take up the issue to the court of law.
Sir, I would like to know, is there any breach of conduct rule on joint representation from government servants in the matter of common interest?
As per government guidelines, making joint representation by government servant on common issues should be viewed as subversive of discipline, and such representations should not therefore be entertained. Every government servant making a representation should do so separately and in his own name.
Ma'am, I have heard about she books. Could you please clarify about it and how can we use it?
This is a very informative question, especially for our working women. Basically, this is an online complaint management system titled as Sexual Harassment Electronic Box, that is SheBox. It was launched by Ministry of Women and Child Development on 24 July 2017. Any woman working or visiting any office of central government can file complaint through this SheBox. Once complaint is submitted to the SheBox, it will be directly sent to the internal complaint committee of the concerned department, and after the inquiry by ICC, the action will be taken by the disciplinary authority under Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013. And now, SheBox portal can be accessed at www.shebox.nic.in. I hope I cleared your answer.
Ma'am, can representation from relative of government servant be entertained?
This practice is seriously undesirable and such representation should be strongly discouraged. However, only in exceptional cases where due to death or disability of a government servant, he himself is unable to submit his grievances. Thank you.
Sir, I would like to know whether a government servant can put his views on social media platforms criticizing the government policies.
It is a very relevant question in the present age of social networking. As per Rule 9 of CCS Conduct Rules 1964, no government servant is permitted to put his views on any social media platform which has the effect of an adverse criticism of any policy or action of the government.
Sir, whether a government servant can express his or her views on Indian or foreign affairs during foreign visit?
normally government servant visiting foreign countries should refrain from expressing views on Indian or foreign affairs, and in particular from making any written or any oral statement without specific prior approval of the head of the Indian mission in the country he or she is visiting.
Ma'am, what is the purpose of reporting transactions of movable, immovable and valuable property to the government?
Well, the purpose of reporting is to ensure that all immovable and movable property acquired by the government servant after joining the government services are within the means of his income known to the government, and he has acquired such properties after due intimation permission from the government as specified under conduct rule.
One more question, ma'am. What is the gravity of not submitting the annual property return in time by the government servant?
Well, Group A and Group B officers need to submit the annual immovable property return in respect of every calendar year by 31st January of the next year. If they fail to submit, then it forms good and sufficient reasons for instituting disciplinary proceedings against them. Even furnishing wrong information by the government servant attracts strict action against them.
Sir, can a government servant engage in part-time employment after office hours?
The answer to your question is no. Normally, a government servant is not permitted to do any part-time employment on regular basis or contract basis because it is felt that he may not get sufficient time for rest and recreation, which affects attention to his work during office hours, but he or she may be permitted to do casual nature of work like occasional work of literary, artistic or scientific nature.
Ma'am, can a government servant enroll with the Bar Association?
Yes, a government servant is permitted to enroll himself as an advocate, but he is not allowed to engage himself in legal profession either independently or otherwise as long as he is a government servant.
What basic principles are to be borne in mind by government servants while dealing with MPs or MLAs?
There are two basic points which must be kept in mind while dealing with honorable MPs and MLAs. First one is the government servant should show courtesy and consideration to MP and MLAs. Further, second one is, while they should consider carefully or listen patiently to what the MP MLAs may have to say. However, every employee should always act according to rules and regulations laid down on the subject by the government.
Ma'am, my wife purchased a car from her own earnings. Do I need to intimate the same to my department?
Answer to your question is no. If she has purchased a car from her own funds and in her own name, then there is no need to intimate the department. As per rule, transaction entered into by spouse or any member of family of government servant out of his or her own fund in his or her own name would not attract the provisions related to transaction of movable, immovable and valuable property applicable to the government servant.
Sir, what is the difference between administrative action and disciplinary action?
Well, there are basically three major differences between administrative actions and disciplinary actions. First one is administrative actions like warning, reprimand, admonition, advisories, etc. are informal actions which are issued for cautioning the government servants against any minor lapses with a view to tone up efficiency or to maintain discipline. While disciplinary actions are to be taken in the form of minor penalties or major penalties. The second major difference is disciplinary actions may be taken only by disciplinary authority competent under CCS-CCA rules 1965, while administrative actions may be taken even by reporting and reviewing authority. In disciplinary actions, departmental inquiry as per laid down procedures is required to be carried out before imposing any penalty, while no formal inquiry is needed for initiating any administrative actions. Third major difference is communication of written warning to be recorded or not to be recorded. In case of administrative action,
While in case of disciplinary actions, it should be documented. Hope I cleared your query. Thank you.
Sir, my question is, what is dies-none?
Dies-none is basically related to no work, no pay principle. A government employee is expected to perform his assigned official duties for which he is being paid. In case of non-performing his duties, he shall not be eligible for any remuneration. Further, a period of service can be marked as dies-none if the employee is absent without proper permission, the employee, though on duty, leaves without proper permission, and the employee is in office but refuses to perform his assigned duties.
And what is the difference between dies-none with or without break in service?
Dies-none period without break in service is not counted as part of service. When the dies-none is with break in service, the entire past service will stand forfeited and the employee would be deemed as a fresh appointee. In terms of DOPT office memorandum dated 22nd June 2019, read with Rule 27 of CCS Pension Rules and Rule 17A of Fundamental Rules.
Ma'am, I want to know which all acts may be categorized under sexual harassment.
Okay. Well, sexual harassment includes physical contact and advances, or a demand or request for sexual favors, or making sexually colored remarks, or showing pornography, and further promise in any form on the basis of sexual favors also come under the sexual harassment.
Ma'am, what action can be taken against the government servant for non-maintenance of his family?
It is a primary responsibility of every government servant to maintain his or her own family. But if a government servant does not maintain his family, it constitutes to unbecoming of a government servant, and it may be regarded as good and sufficient reason to take action against him under CCS CCA Rules 1965.
Sir, can a junior officer perform an action on the verbal instructions of higher authority?
Yes, a junior officer should act on the oral instructions of higher authority, but written order for the same should have been obtained from the authority as soon as possible.
Ma'am, can a government servant refuse the written order of the superior?
Okay. A government servant cannot refuse the written order of the superior if a government servant refuses or deliberately fails to carry out the written order of the superior. He may be suspended under Rule 10 of CCS CCA Rules 1965, or further suitable disciplinary action may be taken against him.
Can a government servant approach any MP or MLA for one's posting at any station?
No, a government servant should not approach any MPs or MLAs for sponsoring his individual cases. Bringing of direct or indirect influence by the government employee would attract the provisions of Rule 20 of CCS Conduct Rules 1964.
Ma'am, what are the provisions to guard against untouchability?
As per Article 17 of Constitution of India, untouchability is abolished and its practice in any form is forbidden. The practice of untouchability is also an offence under the Untouchability Offences Act 1955. A government servant who is found guilty of practicing untouchability in any form, then suitable disciplinary action will be taken against such person, and he may even considered unfit for public service.
Sir, nowadays we see that a number of government servants invest in stocks, debentures, etc. Is there a limit for the purpose of intimating these transactions to the government?
Yes, of course, the limit has been prescribed by the government. If the cumulative value of total transactions in shares, securities and debentures, etc. in a calendar year exceeds 6 months basic pay of the government servant, then he has to send an intimation to the government for this transaction.
Sir, what action can be taken for subletting of government accommodation?
Subletting of government accommodation by the government servant for pecuniary gains is a grave misconduct. Disciplinary proceedings may be initiated against such government servant under Rule 14 of CCS CCA rules 1965. Since it is a case of grave misconduct, the competent authority may consider placing such government servant under suspension also until the finalization of the disciplinary proceeding. Along with it, Directorate of State may also cancel the accommodation on the ground of subletting.
Ma'am, what action should be taken on any anonymous or pseudonymous complaint?
Okay. As per the latest circular issued by Central Vigilance Commission on 25th November 2014, there is no need to take any action on anonymous and pseudonymous complaints, but such complaints should be filed.
Sir, whether prior permission of government is necessary for employment of near relative of government servant in any company or firm?
Here one thing is to be kept in mind is that no government servant shall use his position or influence directly or indirectly to secure employment for any member of his family in any company or firm with which the employee has or has had any official dealings. In cases of such employment, the facts need to be intimated to the government. However, it is necessary for class 1 officer to get the previous sanction of the government for any such employment.
Sir, I want to buy a property for which I have applied for prior permission from competent authority, but I have not received any communication regarding this. What should I do?
According to Department of Personnel and Training, Office Memorandum dated 7th July 1988 and 30th December 1988, if no communication has been received from the government within 30 days from the date of receipt of government servant application by the department in respect of transactions of movable and immovable property, the employee concerned shall be free to assume that permission has been granted.
Sir, could you please tell us what is the impact of administrative actions such as warning, reprimand, etc. on the promotion of a government servant?
Administrative devices are taken with a view to tone up efficiency and maintaining discipline among the government servants. These administrative actions do not, however, constitute any of the major or minor penalties specified in CCS CCA rules. Thus, this does not constitute a bar for consideration of promotion, but when these are kept on the upper dossier, it will be taken to constitute an adverse entry and the officer so warned will have the right to represent against the same in accordance with the existing instructions relating to communication of adverse remarks and consideration of representation against him.
Achara labhate rayura chara labhate shriyam acharat kirti mapnoti purushah pretya chehcha. Arthat sadachar se manushya ko ayu prapt hoti hai, sadachar se hi lakshmi prapt hoti hai, aur sadachar se hi use is lok aur parlok mein kirti prapt hoti hai.
Thank you very much for your unwavering attention throughout this presentation. We hope that this will be beneficial for you.